Hello everyone, welcome to IMPRINT IAS. I'm Varun Kalar, and today we're going to look at the interview preparation program at IMPRINT IAS. And today we're looking into the interview syllabus and interviews do's and don'ts. Okay, so let's start. So first of all, let's start with the syllabus, right? And this is mentioned in the UPSC Gazette. So what does it say? It says the candidate will be interviewed by a board, right? Right. So it will normally five people. So basically five, right? So obviously there is the main member, and there is normally a person from the Indian Army, a professor from one of the IITs or JNU. Then there is sometimes even a professor from the ISI, or even a former civil servant, right there. So what they have is a record of your career, right? And this is a DAF form that you fill, okay? So here lies the real trick that you have to be really, really careful, right, while filling this form. So the DAF form filling, right, is one of the areas where you really need to focus upon, right? Make sure your hobbies are well prepared. There lies the main trick, right? Normally, the interview will start with your hobby. Now, let's go ahead. So it says he will be asked, or he or she, that is, will be asked questions on matter of general interest. Okay. So what does this mean? So basically, you know, iska matlab hai current affairs pe sawal honge. So basically, right? The idea is current affairs. Okay. Now, in our case, obviously, the Indian economy, the CEA bill, the NIA Act are topics which, you know, obviously, your opinion can be asked upon. Remember, factual information impresses, but obviously it's not mains, right? So at the end of the day, your opinion is the area in which you'll get marks. Okay, that's the basic idea behind it. But obviously, if you do not know a lot of facts, normally you know, a candidate gets discouraged. Okay, now let's go ahead. The interview the object of the interview is to assess the personal suitability of a candidate for a career in public servant service by a board of competent and unbiased observers. So see, competent and unbiased, so they're not biased at all. So don't think that they're pro you know, a certain way of thinking, right? The test is intended to judge the mental caliber of a candidate. In broad terms, this is really an assessment of his intellectual qualities, but also social traits, very important, and his interest in public current affairs. So let me give an example why I say unbiased observer. So this is a very famous IAS of the KJ Alphonse, right? And he was from the Kerala cadre. He was famous for the DDA. You know, so he brought down all those illegal construction in Delhi, right? So during his interview, during that time, there was a very strong you know, viewpoint in India that alcohol should be banned. And during his interview, he actually defended that. So, you know, your opinion matters, the way you argue for your opinion matters. What you say in the opinion might not be that useful, right? So, you know, taking a side doesn't make sure that you'll get high marks, that is. Okay, let's go ahead. So what are the qualities that will be you know, judged upon? So first is mental alertness. We'll talk about this in detail. Critical powers of assimilation, clear and logical exposition, balance of judgment, variety and depth of interest, ability for social cohesion and leadership. This is checked using abstract questions, intellectual and moral integrity. What does this mean? Do not guess whatever might happen, right? Anyhow, we'll, you know, use after some time, we'll come back to these seven qualities. Please do remember these qualities. These are the basis of which you will get marks. Now, how is the interview conducted? Remember, the interview is not of a strict cross-examination. So even if, you know, the interview is going very factual in nature and they're asking you questions after questions. So let me give an example. During my interview, they kept on asking names of, first they asked the names of the northeastern states. So I replied, obviously, right? Sikkim, Assam, Meghalaya, Arunachal, Nagaland, Mizoram, Manipur, Tripura, etc. Right. Then they said the, you know, name of the capitals. Again, I answered, right. That is Sikkim is Gangtok, Assam is Guwahati, right. And then we have Arunachal being, right. Arunachal obviously being Itanagar, then Imphal, then Agartala, and you know, so on. Now they finally came to the governor's name, okay, and basically they were going for JJ Singh being the governor of Arunachal, right? So at that time, that is during my time. So it's, even if they're going factual, they're going towards some conversation. So basically what the, you know, the person, the professor wanted in the interview was, he wanted to discuss India-China ties with me, right? And therefore he was taking me through a long route, right? Instead of directly asking me about India-China relationship. Why? Because he wants to see you know, how strongly assimilated I am, or how stable I am as a person. Okay. So sometimes, you know, they tend to do that. Some other times they basically, there's a natural direct purpose of conversation, which is basically to reveal the mental qualities of the candidate. Remember, interview test is not intended to be a test of the specialized or general knowledge of candidates. We have already been tested through the written exam. So if it's going too factual, try to keep your nerves, have the guts to say, I don't know, right? And then obviously continue. Then candidates are expected to have taken an intelligent interest in not only the special subjects of academic study, but what's also happening around them, modern currents of education, right? Modern currents of thoughts happening around new discoveries like AI, deep learning, etc. So you have to be well aware of that. Normally, I suggest that the 10 days, right? So cover 10 days of newspaper, right? And maybe, you know, the big, the major topics of the last 2 months, right? That's how I would advise in case you would be going for an interview this year. Now, what are the myths that you normally face? Interview questions are not like WhatsApp or what you receive. They will not ask you puzzles normally, right? Very, very rarely this happened. Al Kasarohi did this to one of my students a few years ago, but normally it will not happen. Interview is not a system of rejection or its acceptance. It is a part of the whole process. Your marks are added. So remember, if you have a high written score but a low interview marks, it basically mar your chances of rank. So if you score 180 and around 200, you're definitely in the list normally, right? Remember, it's not a test of your knowledge. Your knowledge has already been tested. Do not guess. Instead of that, it's better to say, I don't know, sir, ma'am. Do not bluff. So if you're caught bluffing, you were at 120, right? Okay. Some interview boards are dreaded to admit that they give low marks. But obviously, everybody has a range. Even if you do a statistical analysis of the various people, the average marks are between 165 to 175. So this is the average marks in every board, right? So, so for example, Bhosle sir will make you very comfortable, but you know, he can make you so comfortable that you would lose yourself and commit blunders. On the other hand, Mr. Basi is very, very strict. He will put you on a spot in the first few minutes, and he would check your mental toughness. It is not a roadies interview, last but not the least. They're very cordial, right? Even if they are rebucking you, it will be very, very, in a very cordial way. What are the basic problems that we face, right? So, you know, normally people will ask you, how should I dress up? So how do I dress up? So male candidates should have a formal suit prepared for this occasion, wear Oxford shoes, have a handkerchief, do not wear, you know, a lot of jewelry. If you have any religious things, please hide them. I would also advise people not to wear rings for that day at least, right? Female candidates should wear, you know, a sari if possible. Get used to it, right? Wear little or no jewelry, right? And obviously male candidates should shave, all right? Unless you are sick or have some religious instruction about it. Do not color your hair for females. Do not wear something glamorous. The interview should focus on your character, not your clothes or jewelry. So, you know, therefore, right, be careful what you're wearing. Okay. One of my students did make this mistake of being very glamorous in the interview. Didn't really work out for her. Before UPSC interview, obviously that's the problem that we face. So one day before the interview, you are like in a mess. Okay, there will be butterflies in your stomach. You know, you're thinking, yaar hoga ki nahi hoga, right? You sometimes even thinking, you know, some accident will happen before the you know, while going, but nothing like that will happen, right? For the girls, it's tough, right? Because obviously you're wearing a sari, you might need your mom to really come out and help you out with there. Once you reach the UPSC interview in Sajar Road, you'll be, you know, made to sit, stand in line, you'll be asked to show your summon letters. Then you go inside. The room is really, really cold, right? You'll sit there for, you know, document verification. So people who are of the same, you know, same board would sit in the same table. Documents will be checked, and finally you will get your board assigned. Candidates are called one on one for the interview, and you head towards respective members' room. A candidate is called 5 minutes before the interview is over and made to sit outside. Normally, what happens is that when you're standing outside, now I'm sitting outside the room and somebody else is inside, or so that's very, very nervous. During my time, multiple times, what I did was I just kept on looking here and there, right, instead of thinking that I'm here for an interview, right? And suddenly when the bell rang, I was like, okay, now the interview has started, and go inside. Okay, now as soon as the bell rings, right, as soon as you enter, the interview has started. Okay, so normally what happens is that you'll be waiting outside and called inside. So as soon as you enter, the chairman is looking at you, you wish him or her and the other members wish good morning. If it's before 12, after 12 it's good afternoon, and if it's late in the evening, right after 4, do wish them good evening. Make sure you wish each and every one of them, right? And let's say he gives you the seat. The situation is actually perfect. Thank them individually, right, for giving you the chair, right, and the others as well. But sometimes what happens there, you come inside, that's a situation too, right, that, you know, are you waiting outside and called inside while walking? So, kya hua? And now what happens is that they're looking at the DAF or something they're reading. In that situation, you have to start wishing everybody in a firm but loud enough voice to attract some attention. Even if they do not go, you know, look at you, you know, sit next to the chair, do not touch the chair. Do not ask to be seated. Just stand and wait for them to look at you. They will give you the chair, right? Ask, do not ask whatever might happen, right? That's something which is very, very important. Most people make this mistake, all right? You should be very comfortable standing. You should, you know, because if you ask to be seated, it seems as if you're nervous or you're in a hurry, right? So don't be in a hurry. Once you've been given the chair, thank the chairman and the other members for being given the chair. Normally, the interview will start with an introduction or something very informal, right? So, like this, right? So, the chairman says, Mr. or Mrs. X, or whoever it might be, feel comfortable, take a deep breath. And I see a smart young lady in front of me who has a very good academic record, right? So, are you nervous? So, when you get this type of welcome, you feel confident, and but utilizes a two-edged sword. It means they expect you to a lot from you, and you got to deliver. So you have to obviously thank them for their compliment, and at the same time you have to say, sir, I'm not nervous, but obviously excited to be here. Normally the chairman would straight go for your hobbies. I would like everybody to fill such DAF, and you know, so the achievements and your hobbies should have a positive correlation. If that's the case, it's easy to justify in the interview, right? Prepare your hobbies in detail. If you think about it, let's say you play chess. So if you have a nationals in chess, it, you know, makes sense, right? That you okay. So people normally tend to do, they put different hobbies and different achievements. So normally that leads to incoherence, right? But normally the kind of hobbies you would have and the kind of achievements you might have would be actually correlated. So like if you're a person who has a good memory power, you would be good at playing chess as well as quiz contests, etc. Now, what is checked in the interview? So there are a few qualities which have been mentioned in the DAF itself. So the quality number one is mental alertness. So how it is checked, people might ask you. So first of all, kya hota hai ki, let's say you're coming from, let's say, you know, Tamil Nadu or something. Now, while you're coming in, so they ask you, how did you come? So you say, as I came by train, by plane or whatever. So they ask you, what did you see while coming, right? Which stations were there, which, train you took, etc. So they will ask you to name the states you passed through, right? Other ways are obviously they ask you to name the states of the Northeast while a map is present. So the idea is you should point to the map and then say, so this is the place. Okay. or if there are Mughal paintings in the room, or there's some painting in the room. So if they ask you something about that painting, obviously you should be alert enough to understand that there is a painting of Mughals, right, or a Jahangir painting in the room. There are other methods as well, at various interviews, you can ask the number of electrical equipments in the room, etc., etc., or the number of steps you took while coming inside, or the number of plants are there in the Holpur house or something like that. Then they look at critical power of assimilation. This is the second. Okay, and normally this is checked by giving information about a topic in the interview and then asking a similar question in the interview, like talking about decision making theory and then linking it to playing chess. So decision making theory is taught in Pavan. So my option was public administration, and they linked it with my hobby, that is chess. So they do have linkages and went. What else? The third quality we look at is clear and logical exposition of thoughts. Now, here is where most people actually lose their marks. What happens is that people say that interview ki kya preparation karni, kyu answer banane, kyu try karna, just mock denge bas ho jayega. But idea is to give written, prepare written answers to expected questions. So every mock you take, make a list of all the questions that were asked, make written answers, rehearse them in front of a mirror. Do not leave any stone unturned. Right? Because remember, it's very difficult to increase 10 marks in mains, but very easy to increase 10, 20 marks in your interview farewell. Then obviously balance of judgment. This is obviously asked by giving controversial questions like Ram Mandir, CA, or even something similar as corruption, or asking your opinion about a political leader. Always give a positive but balanced view about things. Okay, even if this asking you about the CA, which is very controversial. Talk about the fact that this was a long-standing demand and India has always been a home to all the refugees in the world, of various minorities, that is. Do not go into the controversial aspects unless they point them out. Then finally, obviously, one of the most important areas is variety and depth of interest. And this is checked using two things, ACADS and your hobbies. So a detailed FAQ should be made on this, right? So that's something that I think offline you can actually mention your hobbies on the comments, and I think we can create a FAQ list. Create at least 20-25. You should be well versed with the theoretical as well as the practical aspects. So theory, let's say you play chess, so the theory of chess, when it was started, etc., historical aspects of it, right? And obviously the practical. So obviously you should know which all tournaments are going, who's the world number one. Obviously you should be able to talk about it. The other is obviously ability for social cohesion and leadership. This is checked using abstract questions. They make you the PM, DM, etc., the ministry, the minister, that is, and then they ask you to tackle a situation, right? They make you secretary of a ministry and then ask you, what would you do about drug problem in Punjab? So obviously this is the full toss and perhaps the most scoring. Please prepare a question like this. This is very important because here they're giving you the chance to become a PM or CM or even a secretary of a department. So it's wonderful. And you should obviously start by answering that, thank you so much, sir, for giving me this opportunity and this responsibility. And then start answering. Focus is on intellectual and moral integrity. Do not lie and do not guess in any scenario in an interview. Integrity is foremost. Even if you don't answer 20 questions, fine, but if you don't have integrity, it means you'll get 110 120 marks if you slip there, right? So anybody who scored less than 120 means like he lied or something. Okay, the most interesting fact is that even if you're able to prove any one of these, like any one of these seven qualities, that is mental alertness, critical powers of assimilation, clear logical exposition of thoughts, balance of judgment, variety and depth of interest, ability for social cohesion, intellectual moral integrity, any of them, you'll get 180 at least, or even more than that. It's very difficult to prepare. It's very difficult to show these qualities. If you prepare well, you can should do it easily. Do not get discouraged even if you're not able to answer the question. Keep going, try to answer the next question. Even if you're not able to answer 10 questions in a row, continue. Do not give up. Do not get your chin down. Always believe in yourself. Ask them to ask you another question. Try that, especially in ACADS, because there'll be a lot of ACADS questions, right? And you're not really prepared for them. So if you know, try to answer them even if you don't know. Remember, excuses are frowned upon. Do not say that, yeah, sir, bahut time pehle, you know, prepare. I was in college, so please do not ask me this question. Don't say these things. If you give an excuse, you're in 140, 150 territory. Do not use filler words like I think, basically, obviously. Make your answers so clear and logical exposition of thoughts. That, okay? Think before you speak. Take a minute sometimes, right? It's fine if you take a minute. Do not overlap. If a member cuts you, and you know, there should be no overlapping. So let's say you're answering about Indian economy and the third person starts asking you about US-China trade. Stop your Indian economy answer and start answering the US-China trade, right? Go to the next one. Then the other three things, which are obviously we'll talk about later, maybe I'll put some videos on this. So hand movement, try to maintain no hand movement stance. Keep your hands on your thighs. Remember, you're supposed to speak your answer, not needed. Hands are not needed normally to speak. Head movement should be natural. Some nodding, obviously, while they're asking you a question should be fine, but try to keep it natural. Check this by making videos of your mocks, right? Whether if your nodding is not that good. Eye contact, especially, because sometimes, you know, people need to think, you know, towards the sky while thinking, as if some, you know, some god is going to appear and answer this question, but that doesn't really happen. But so what you're trying to do is like look in between the members, right, while thinking. That's a good idea, I would say. Do not look up, right? Do not look above at the ceiling, right, while answering. And do not look down as well, I think, right? That also looks very bad as a body language stance. Okay, so keep these things in mind. You know, try to obviously look, you know, do mirror exercises. And take a lot of video mocks so that you can actually check yourself there, right? Do not really, you know, try to use every mock as your, you know, improvement rather than as a way to judge yourself, right? Even if somebody says you're going to score 150 or you're going to score 200, it doesn't mean that. It depends on the day. So believe in yourself and best of luck, I would say, right? Remember, the end of the interview normally would be abrupt, right? Do not mind that. Thank them individually, right, for the time. If you know they say thank you so much, right, so and so. Do not say welcome, right. You thank them instead. You know, sometimes what happens if somebody says thank you, you say welcome, right. Be alert, right, even at the end of your interview. Do not turn your back too quickly. Walk a couple of steps while walking back and then turn. Needs practice. I think we'll put a video while, you know, of entrance and exit. This is something that you really need to work upon. Also, you know, walking a sari, shaving every day again is a big deal, right? I think for most people who, you know, like us, so, you know, during our prep, we didn't shave for months. Now you're asking us to shave every day. So obviously we have to be careful at the same time, comfortable in those clothes, right? Okay, so that's it from us. If you have any questions, do comment on this, or you can send your DAF to our email or to our Telegram group. I think we are more than happy to analyze your DAF, right? Thank you so much for listening to us.